this is John Cole with GrowingYourGreens.com to do another exciting episode for you. We're here in November, and you guys are going to get a taste sampling tour of my garden. I have special guests here, Lissa.
Hello.
From Raw Food Romance. She has her own YouTube channel where she educates people on eating healthy plant-based food. So, Lissa, you want to explain to everybody about your channel and what you do there? I know you're a great chef and photographer, and you have ebooks teaching people how to eat healthier.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so my YouTube channel is Lissa's Raw Food Romance, and on Instagram I'm at Raw Food Romance. And yes, I like to take pictures, I like to create beautiful, amazing dishes with plant foods. So I'm excited to taste some stuff in your garden that I might want to use in some of my dishes.
Yeah, so my goal today with Lissa is to basically take her out and feed her every edible leaf that I am growing right now. I don't know, is this gonna be at least 3 dozen, 4 dozen, 5 dozen? Am I gonna have 100? I don't know, but we're gonna take around and she's gonna get one leaf of every different thing to give you guys her opinions on that so that you guys could learn about some of these more unique, rare foods, or some of even more common foods, but just homegrown foods, because I know you guys eat a lot of store-bought foods. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you grow your own food, you could do things to the soil, like add trace minerals, you could add all the biology and beneficial microbes and fungi and mycelium that just make the whole system work better, so you have more nutritious food, in my opinion and based on my taste buds. But this is a good opportunity for you to taste the difference. Mm-hmm. And also explain to my viewers out there on some of these more different foods that most people never get to eat. And hopefully in this video you guys will be inspired to maybe grow one or two or even more of these different foods based on what Lissa says and what she thinks as like a chef that creates foods and spreads out healthy eating to others. So anyways, let's go ahead and head into the garden. Woo. So this is my garden. It's pretty much kind of an overgrown garden here in November. The weathers are cooling, the basil's not looking quite as vibrant as it did earlier. You can see some of the colder damage that we had, some of my basils on the other side that maybe weren't as well watered, totally lost it. But I still have basil, I still have basically all my summer greens, and the other cool thing is now I'm planting the winter greens. She's gonna get to taste some baby winter greens. Mm. So over on this side, I think I have a few things. First, we have the water spinach. This guy grows really easily, and let's see, it's not looking super good right now because it's getting colder, but you could try a water spinach leaf.
Mm. Water spinach. Mmm. Not as strong as like a typical spinach.
Yeah, so this is store. Yeah, this is not related to the Olicera spinach that I actually have growing on the other side of the garden, but it's called a spinach. Like a lot of greens that could be eaten are called spinaches, like in foreign countries. So I have like different kinds of spinach that are not even related to our standard spinach.
Oh wow. Yeah, it was very fresh, really mild. Mm. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, that's like my summer lettuce because it just grows like rampant. It could take over waterways, and in some states like Florida, it's a noxious weed.
Wow.
All right, so over here, let's see, we're gonna go ahead and just probably grab one leaf. This is actually lemon basil, I believe.
Lemon basil.
Yeah. Yeah, a little lemon basil. Lemon. Tastes
for
like
sure.
Lemon. Yeah.
Lemon.
It's cool, huh?
That is so cool. Yeah, it's not even really like a basil. Like, if you didn't say it was basil, I probably
would. Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah, but I would say, wow, that tastes like lemon.
Yeah, that's
sure.
A cool one. Yeah, it doesn't make a lot of leaves. It stays really strong, and my Italian basil, you know, overgrew it, so we'll give you a nice leaf of Italian. Don't take the flower, you'll get jacked up. It'll be too strong.
Mmm.
That's a much more classic, solid, like, boom in your face, like basil for pesto or something.
That's a good one. Very fresh, like it's got a like a cold flavor too in the mouth, kind of like mint. But
oh,
not,
like the menthol kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I tasted that. Okay, and then right behind you, down here, things growing everywhere. Thai basil.
Thai basil, I love Thai basil.
Yeah, that's like my favorite basil to grow.
Yes. Yep.
It's a good flavor.
Mm-hmm.
So of all the basils, which one did you like more?
Oh my gosh, I really liked the lemon one.
It's more mild, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then obviously like the Thai. But yeah, this was good too. They're all good. They all have their own
unique things.
Flavor.
That's why I try to grow as many varieties as possible. And there's a basil, I believe, called lettuce leaf basil that is really mild, and I've been wanting to grow that one forever. So now if we go to this side, we have a lot more things growing. I mean, just down here. Oh, this one's a fun one. This is called Chinese chives.
Chinese chives. I'm a big chive fan.
So. Oh yeah. So that's a real. I like. I won't. Well, I'm not gonna say how they taste because you gotta eat it.
Mmm. Wow. That's probably my favorite.
Yeah. It's just so mild. You have that slight onion flavor, but you could like put a lot of this on a salad, and it's not gonna be like. It's blowing up my mouth or anything. It's just so nice.
Exactly. Yeah. Because we like the onion flavor, but for some
not
people, it's too much. And yeah. Oh, I want to grow that.
Actually, you could grow that one indoors pretty easily, actually.
Ooh.
All right. So the next thing here, this is called faux tea, and that's just taken over, and it's actually flowering for the first time.
Wow.
And so this is a good time to eat it because in the summer it gets really like hardcore, but right now there's a lot of new baby tender growth here. So like even just picking one of these nice little baby leaves, faux tea is like a traditional like Chinese medicine. They usually use the roots, but you could eat the greens.
Wow. I don't even know how to describe that.
It's so different.
It's really, I want to say grounding and it's got a really full flavor. Mm. It's so hard to describe. It's hard because we don't eat this kind of stuff on a regular basis.
And there's nothing really. It just tastes like its own thing. You can't say this tastes like spinach or this tastes like kale. It tastes like faux tea, which is like, you don't really know. I mean, how would you describe it? Savory, sweet, bitter? Mm. What are the senses?
Bitter, savory. I want to say umami.
Mmm, interesting.
It's got like kind of like grounding, like full flavor. But also kind of nutty at the same time. But yeah, bitter, definitely I could feel the bitterness
in
there.
Yeah, bitter greens in moderation are good for us. That being said, some of the greens in my garden, you know, you might not want to make a salad out of them, but like, you know, using some of these leaves in with a salad made out of lettuce that I've grown on the other side would probably be a really good thing to do. And so like some of these things I just don't eat in mass quantities. There's a lot of research on some of the plants that could be safe in large quantities, but some of these other plants, you may want to be cautious. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, faux tea can be eaten raw, but that's one of the ones I'm kind of cautious about. And then if we go over here, we have a more standard green tree collards.
Ooh, tree collards.
Yeah, so these are tree collards, green tree collards that are growing up.
Mm. And this I love the color.
Yeah, good time to eat them right now.
Fresh.
Yeah, well, it's just picked.
I know, it's like, just like.
The flavor? How do you compare to like a store-bought collard green?
Oh, it's way better.
And yeah, that's a tender young one too, you know.
Way better. I feel like, yeah, it's almost like there's more flavor in these, obviously, because they're homegrown, they're not mass-produced.
And they're, I mean, they're more rich and watery. They're not, I mean, when they ship stuff and cut it, it's dehydrating on the journey. Mm-hmm. And then it's just not quite as, like, rich.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, much, much, much more flavor. I would say, I would love to do a wrap with that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. This, I only have one or two of these. Well, I have some more actually back there. But
you know, the stems of these are actually a lot nicer to eat too. Whereas the stems of some, like, store-bought collards are a little bit more, they're rougher, they're not as flavorful, and we, like, tend to cut them off and throw them away.
All right. Well, juicing them is always good.
Mm-hmm. But those ones were like
you could just eat them, like
pleasant to eat.
Yeah, like even mild, softer than celery or something to me. But once again, you got a young leaf. So here's the thing, Lissa. Like when I harvest ones to eat for my salad, I'll pick the top ones. But like if they're harvesting them for selling, they're harvesting the bottom ones.
Right.
It grows from the top. The top ones are the young baby ones that have tender fibers. As the plant gets more mature, they harvest off the bottom, so they're much more like stronger and the fibers are more thick and they're not as delicate. So I mean that's just a reason to grow your own food because now you could harvest off the top. I harvest off the top for eating raw and fresh in salads and then for smoothies or blending or juicing, you know, I'll harvest off the bottom because I mean the plant's giving me both, but you don't want to harvest too much off the top because then the plant will stop growing. But yeah, growing your own really gives you a lot of flexibility. Now I even have more stuff down here like hiding. So this is a nice fun one, man. I barely even eat them when they're like this. This is basically leek greens, baby leek greens, because they're just right off the top there.
All right. Mmm. Wow.
Compare the onion on that compared to the flat leek.
Wow, that's strong.
Strong.
But good strong, not bad strong. Like, I could eat more. Yeah, definitely that one was more mild.
Way more mild.
Yeah. More sweet, too.
Uh-huh.
This one is definitely intense, but not as intense as, like, actually eating a leek.
Well, yeah, because that's also, this is young baby leek greens as they're just emerging for the season. And usually the leek greens, when you get, they're really old. They've been grown a long time. They're more fibrous.
Yeah, definitely.
And people don't usually necessarily eat the greens. They might cook them up because they're just so fibrous.
Yeah, like we'll chop them up and freeze them so that we can put them in our soups and stuff. Just for the variety, but those are good.
Yeah. Let's see another one here. We got one of these leaves. Let me see what this is. I think that's like a, is that like a, well, taste it and let me know what you think it tastes like.
Okay.
Then I'll tell you what I think it is. I have a lot of things that look like that.
Parsley?
Yeah, so that, I think that's flat leaf Italian parsley.
Definitely. And, wow, it's so much better than store-bought too.
Yeah, isn't it just like much more flavor? It's just right here, it came up, I think it probably just came up on from seed. I didn't plant it necessarily. This is a, this bed is just a jungle bed. It has just stuff randomly growing in there. And here's another one. This is fun. Let's give you a leaf of this stuff. If you've tasted this before. I won't say the name until you taste it because it might kind of give you an idea what it tastes like. I don't know.
Wow.
That's one of my favorites.
That is good. It's like, it's almost like a combination of all kinds of things. Like oregano, mint, parsley, all at the same time. What is it?
If it was your cats would go crazy over it.
Oh, is it catnip?
It's cat mint, yeah, catnip, cat mint.
Wow.
Yeah, I eat it, and cats love it too.
Oh my gosh.
So yeah, the next plant you're gonna try is this right here. Ooh. And actually, these are my sweet potato vine. These are purple sweet potato vine. I have two varieties. I don't know which is which at this point. But sweet potato leaves are edible, so we're gonna harvest you like a nice baby leaf here to eat. You can't eat them raw. You could also cook them up. Most people cook them up.
Sweet potato.
Yeah, purple sweet potato leaf.
Mmm.
What does that taste like?
Wow. It almost tastes like, I don't want to say like a sweet potato, but it's like more creamy.
Creamy?
Mm-hmm. Creamy, mild.
Bitter at all?
Soft.
Or sweet?
It's a little bitter, but not very bitter. I wouldn't necessarily categorize it as that, but creamy.
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 A creamy green.
It's a creamy green.
You heard it here first. That's a baby one. Once again, I could have harvested you one from the bottom that's been sitting here all summer in the summer heat.
Yeah.
More fibrous, and it'd be more drying. But once again, you go, if you guys are going to pick things to eat fresh, you know, gardeners have the choice. If you go to the Asian market and try to buy sweet potato greens, which you could do, you know, they're going to be much more older, going to be more dehydrated, not grown in good soil, and they're not going to be quite as probably as tasty as these guys. But yeah, I've... These are actually closely related to the water spinach that I have right here that's in like in the same family.
Okay.
They're like the same kind of vining plants. But I like the water spinach for eating a little bit better than this personally. All right, let's keep heading back here. This is another one of my mixed beds that has gone crazy. You can see my tree collards are like 12 feet tall here. These are the green tree collards, survived the summer with no shading. I thought I would need shading on them, but I just increased the watering and they're doing quite good. They kind of, you know, chilled out during the summer, but now they're coming back strong as the weather's cooling. In this bed, we have a lot of just different things planted. So let's see, I think this, we got some Swiss chard. That's like bolting Swiss chard. So you can try a little baby leaf of that.
Mild.
Really mild.
Sure.
Well, yeah, because once again, baby leaf.
Baby leaf.
More mild.
I want to say it's like, it's got more of a mineral flavor.
Yeah. Chard always more minerally, like I would say, you could say salty, but it's just minerals. Mm-hmm. You're tasting all the minerals.
Mineral, because I want to say like metallic, but not
quite like
there.
In the stalks of the chard is always, if you just juice the chard stalks, it's really minerally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like that one. That was nice.
And let's see, we got this one here. One little sprig is just coming in for the winter.
Ooh.
So, well, you want to, you'll know what that one is.
I think I know what this one is.
You'll know what that one is.
Mm-hmm. Dill. Ooh, it's sweet.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Fresh grown picked dill. I use that in my recipes for salad dressings. It's so good.
That's good.
next little sprig was kind of growing down there, and this has grown for like 2 years now. I got this from Wendy at Wendyland. I think this is a rock samphire. Normally grows by the coast. But it just grows as a perennial here in the desert, and it's really just, it takes a while to get established, but then it started to grow really good. Mm. That's a unique flavor.
That's a really unique flavor. I don't even know how to just really, not licorice-y, but it's got that kind of angle, but it's not licorice-y at all. Like, again.
Minerally?
Minerally. Not quite bitter, but it's got bitters in there. Wow, that's so different. That's so interesting, though, because there's so many flavors that we don't even...
Yeah, people just eat lettuce and kale and Swiss chard and spinach, maybe, and there's a lot of Asian greens, some of which you're going to try today, and then there's so many other weird... This is like more of a wild food, so I don't just try to grow cultivated foods. I grow many of them, but I try to even grow some of the wild foods because they could be more nutritious for you, actually, and actually also... They're easier to grow than cultivated foods because they have to defend themselves in the wild against, you know, things that eat them. Mm-hmm. So that's why I like to grow them so much. I mean, they could literally be called weeds in some cases.
And they taste good.
Yeah, all right, let's continue on back. So we got a couple of plants over here. These are actually in pots. Actually, these two plants are in the same pot. So this is actually the red boar kale that's actually grown. I planted it about last year this time, and then it was my only plant that made it through the summer.
Oh, wow.
So this has gone through the full summer, and now it's regrowing. I'm also going to be planting some babies today of that. Mm. So it'll be interesting what you think about the...
Oh, really minerally.
Red boar kale, so like really strong. Yeah, strong. So probably because it came through the whole summertime, it produces a lot of those more strong flavors is what I would say.
Mm-hmm. But it's not like overpowering kale-y. It's like... more balanced of a flavor, but a lot of flavor. I like that one a lot.
And then plus it's got the purple anthocyanins that I love so much. Mm-hmm. All right, next one. This one, I think this is probably my only plant that made it because in the freeze, a lot of them, but we got cold maybe down to 40 and a lot of my plants like just totally checked out. But this guy is continuing to live. This is actually called the Egyptian spinach.
Oh.
Or mallowhea. I think in Egypt, and this is like, they do a lot of cooking with this. It grows really well in the summer heat. It doesn't like when it gets too cold.
Mmm, very mild.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And this is supposed to be one of those super leafy greens with like more nutrition than carrots and all these crazy things.
Oh, so good. Yeah, you could easily it's really eat a whole mild. Salad of those.
Yeah, that's an easy one you could eat as a salad. Some things are and some things aren't. All right, so up above us here, we have this tall tree, and this is just a moringa.
Moringa!
And then we could just bend it down here, and then when I like to eat the moringa, I bend it down and just get this center tip growth. So this is very special, because most people, when they harvest the leaves, especially when they're dried, they get the old stuff. But we could harvest the young babies for you to eat. They're so cute.
Oh, thank you. They are so cute.
Try that. Baby moringa.
Wow.
Yeah, that's a punch, huh? Even for the baby leaves.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, boom.
Wow. I can't even describe it. It's just, I wish people could grow this stuff in their backyard and taste it.
They can, depending on where you could grow this as an annual anywhere in the United States during your warm season. Here, what happens is it doesn't like the cold, so I cut it back, and then the roots come up again, or the plant regrows in the springtime. I'm in a zone 9A, I think. And if you're in a zone, you know, lower than that, then you need to protect it or bring it in, grow it in a pot, and bring it in the winter.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Yeah, it's very herbally, I want to say.
Herbally.
Mm-hmm. Like, it's got that strong, like, herbal flavor. I don't know. It's so hard to describe.
It's like, kind of like hot. Right?
Yeah,
isn't it
like
hot and
kind of
like spicy, like a strong brassica, like a strong kale? But that's because it also contains the isothiocyanates that are good for detox and, you know, anti-cancer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely has a heat to it.
Cool.
A nice warming heat.
All right, let's see what else we got over here. All right, well, right down below me here, we got one of my favorite basils. First year now, it's going to flower. Made it through the entire summer. These ones a little bit different. Then my standard basil. This is actually called green pepper basil. I probably shouldn't have told you the name before I fed it to you. because now you're maybe pepper. Now you're expecting what it's going to taste like.
It's nice and rough too.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. not like a tender leaf basil. It's like more like hardy.
Yeah, it's
like
hardy.
A more fibrous, and that's why this one has survived over I think a winter or two now. I might protect it a little bit, but it survives the cold better than a standard basil just freezes out.
Mm-hmm. Very fibrous.
Yeah.
Very fibrous. Peppery. Mm-hmm. Almost like black pepper, but not.
You think black pepper or green pepper?
Green pepper.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, green pepper. Mmm, that's good. I like the fibrousness of it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like chewy. Mm-hmm. Yum.
All right, then we have back here, we have another spinach plant. It's not related to the regular spinach. This is probably one of my favorites.
Oh, it's soft.
I lost a lot of them this year. Yeah, it's really soft. That's a longevity spinach or Gynera procumbens.
Mmm, very hydrating.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's like kind of succulently.
Mm-hmm. I like the spinaches because they're really satisfying. Mm. Like they have kind of like that thick flavor, I guess. I want to say protein, but...
Well, that's a little mucilaginous on that one.
Mmm, yep. Yeah, that was good. Mild too, again.
Yeah, really mild. Yep. That's one of my favorite summer greens.
Mm-hmm.
All right, then you have a special one here. Let's see if I even remember the name of this one. We could find you a nice leaf here. Once again, it's just right now it's growing. Oh, you're gonna get a nice leaf. This is a nice little baby leaf here. Let's see. It's green on the top, purple on the back.
Ooh.
Let me know. It's
super soft.
Yeah, super soft, and like smell it though too before you eat it. It has a really unique scent. This is a Vietnamese or Asian, South Asian leafy green, and I don't even know if I remember the name. And that was a small leaf too, huh? So much flavor in just a small leaf.
Wow. Nutty, bitter, but powerful. I can't even describe what it tastes like.
It tastes like its own thing. Like it has its own unique flavor. And if you put too many of these in a salad, you just taste this. You don't taste a salad anymore. So I like to just put like a handful of these in an entire big soup, and then every once in a while I'll get a crunch on it, like, oh, that there it is.
Yep, it definitely is unique.
And I forget the name of this one actually, so what I'm gonna do for you guys, I'm gonna put a list of all the different plants in the description in order, so I'll have the name of this one in there. I got it from like the nursery in Texas that I visited, and this came back on the plane one day. All right, and then this one, you can eat raw too, and the leaves are more, let's find a nice baby leaf again for you. This one's actually called grass jelly.
Grass jelly.
The cool thing about this is they in Asia, you could basically make jello with it by just blending up the leaves in water, and then it just put it in the fridge, and then it'll just firm up.
Really?
And then
I can tell.
It's very interesting. It's kind of the...
In the mouth, yeah.
Yeah, the mucilage or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm. Mild, still. Could you eat a salad of those?
I'm not sure, so that's why, you know, I would add a few to a salad versus a salad of them. And also, like, that one is not a super fast grower for me. It's not supposed to, like, it could die back in the winter. Last year I don't think I protected it. I was too lazy. But it's, like, it survived, and we got barely below freezing. But, you know, this is also on my warmest wall, so that it gets direct sun even in the winter time, so the wall warms up and it keeps the plants warmer. Plus I put some Christmas tree lights to keep this whole area warm. If I'm really into it, I might, you know, put a whole, you know, burlap cloth over this whole little area just to kind of keep it covered, to keep it warmer. So this one definitely should not be eaten raw in any large quantities. You can get cyanide poisoning.
Ooh. All right, good to know.
So I'm feeding you a very small leaf. Find a nice baby small leaf so you're in no peril. But yeah, some of my friends that eat raw say you could eat a lot of these, but like, be cautious. They should only be cooked. It has a cyanogenic glycosides in there.
I could see why it would be easy to eat a lot of them.
What's the flavor to you?
When I first had it in my mouth, it was really sweet
and
sticky. And then it became more bittery.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. But it wasn't as bitter as I thought it would be.
Well, we got you a baby leaf too. So if we give you like a mature leaf, which I would not do, you know, because that may be problematic. I mean, I'll pick a bunch of these and add it to a salad, but like only less than two or three. Mm-hmm. You know, I will not pick a lot of them. That's why I still have a lot of leaves on here. But it's a beautiful plant. It reminds me of like a papaya.
Mm.
It has like a similar leaf shape.
Yeah, they are really, I like the sweetness.
Yeah, until you get the bitter. Yeah, it's really unique.
Yeah, definitely.
Here's a plant that was planted in the spring and it's just kind of hanging in there. Most of it kind of died back, but we still got a few leaves on here. All right, I'm not gonna tell you what it is because you'll know the flavor if I told you.
Wow.
Maybe you don't know it.
I don't. It is licorice-y. Is it anise?
Does it say sweet?
Yes, very sweet. Like cinnamon?
Cinnamon. Tastes cinnamon. Mm.
Cinnamony, anise-y. Now I want to know what it is.
Stevia.
Stevia. Yes, it's exactly stevia.
Tastes just like, it is stevia.
It's been like a decade since I've had stevia.
Like fresh stevia or dried usually?
I had some fresh leaves like a long time, like 15 years ago.
Wow.
So now tasting that, now that you say it, I'm like, back. Yes, it's exactly. But yeah, stevia is actually better than the actual like products that you buy in the store.
Yeah, because when they dehydrate the whole leaves, then it kind of gets weird, but fresh is so much better. And also there's different cultivars, varieties, and some will have more stronger aftertastes than others, and I don't know what variety this is. And also it's gone through a hot summer.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that sweetens it up. And then these guys don't generally last during the winter. They check out.
Ah, they're good.
So this is the next one we're gonna try. So I want you to try that and tell me what it tastes like. I think I know what it is.
Ooh, that's another parsley.
Oh, so it's a flat leaf parsley, or I'm thinking, I know I think I might have a celery over there. No, sorry, that's a flat leaf parsley.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Okay, now this one, which looks similar, but it's right next door. Shouldn't have told you what it is. Now you know.
They look so similar.
Yeah, they're like the same family, and you gotta look at the plants, and I get them confused.
Oh, wow, celery.
Yeah, isn't that celery, like, boom in your face? Ooh. Like, we get the celery stalks you buy at the store are like just lame weak.
Not even close.
This just like blows up in your mouth.
If
like,
you
boom.
Had a celery from the store on a scale of 1 to 10, a celery from the store is like a 1.5. This is like a 12.
Yeah, man.
It's like, oh.
I can't even juice a lot of that. It'll just make the whole thing bitter.
Mm-hmm. Super crazy. Bitter. It's got that celery flavor. But yeah, really minerally.
And yeah, but how much stronger and more nutritious is celery leaves and celery juice? Maybe that we should be being told to drink celery leaf juice, but then people wouldn't be compliant because it tastes so like crabby.
Wow. That's,
that's strong. Yeah, I don't even eat a lot of that. All right, so let's see. We got, here's a nice treat here. So this one is called, this guy little right here. It's actually known as a landscape plant for many places.
A landscape plant.
Let me see if I remember the name.
Very rubbery.
Yeah.
Whoa. Hydrating.
Yep.
Oh wow.
It's succulent. It's like a succulent.
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh.
It's called aptinia.
It was like as soon as I took a bite, it was like with hydration and flavor. I don't even know.
Like any tastes like any green or more mild or bitter, sweet.
More mild, but strong mild. Not very, you have to have another one.
All right, yeah, sure, we got a lot. Sure, it's like a weed.
It's sad, too, because a lot of us haven't had a wide variety
to
compare to, right?
This is another wild food that's commonly used as a landscape plant here. And it's like, you could eat it. It makes these nice flowers, too, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's almost like if you injected spinach with water.
So it's like a fluffy spinach.
Mm-hmm. Because as soon as you take a bite, it's like eating a grape. It's like tons
blows
of like,
up.
Water. Yeah.
That's how it survives the desert.
Mm-hmm. That's really good. Wow.
Oh, cool. Yeah, aptinia. Yeah, I have lots of that stuff growing. All right, so let's see. Oh, let's try this one here. These are kind of, I don't have a lot of leaves because this plant's always struggling, but we'll pull out one leaf. It's barely making it. It's purple. I like it because it's purple.
Oh wow, it's so pretty.
That's it. That, you'll know what that kind of tastes like.
It almost looks like a flower.
Yeah, no, they're just like leaves of three.
Whoa. You know? That's like
light
lemon. Oh my gosh, lemony, very lemony, citrusy, but
like what?
I don't even know. It's definitely lemony, I would have to say, is the biggest thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's like oxalis, or like related to sorrel.
Okay.
It's purple oxalis, I believe. You know, I don't even know the right name. It's normally not necessarily even grown for eating, and actually it's high in oxalates, so you don't even want to eat a lot of them anyways.
Yeah. That was good.
Yeah.
It would be hard not to eat a lot of those.
Really? You liked it?
I really liked it, yeah. I really like sour lemony stuff too, so.
Oh, good. You might like this next one too then. Let me see if I could find...
If it's spicy, if it's lemony.
Well, this one just broke off, so you could have a whole thing here.
Wow.
This is off a tree that I'm growing. This tree is small. I have trees larger over there. This is known as the bele.
Wow. All right, let's start with a little piece.
Yeah, well, this one's gonna be more tough because it's, you know, more of an older, yeah, older leaf than a younger baby leaf.
Mmm. Oh, wow. It's like chia.
Like, yeah, like it's really mucilaginous. Yeah.
Wow. Totally like chia. Like if you mixed, it's not even really spinachy. Kind of, it's super mild, but totally like eating the chili or chia
that's been
gelled.
Soaked.
Yeah, that's been soaked, totally. But with a really mild flavor.
Yeah, you could use it like as a thickener. Like if I blend it up into a smoothie, it just makes it kind of gloopy.
Yeah, totally. Oh, that's really cool.
Yeah.
It's neat too because it's not always the flavor, it's the texture.
Textures.
That's so different that you're like, I don't even know what that tastes like.
But some people don't like these mucilaginous textures, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think it's good to appreciate all the different textures, especially the mucilaginous textures, because the mucilages is actually beneficial fibers that could feed your microbiome, which science is showing could be quite beneficial.
My microbiome's having a party right now.
Yeah, I'm sure it is. You're getting such the diversity that nobody else in Vegas really gets, except maybe me.
Totally.
All local, really fresh picked, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All right, wow. Cool. Let's see if I can dig and find another thing over here in this crazy bed. Yeah, we'll see if you like this one.
Okay.
This one is actually called New Zealand spinach. All the way, grows in New Zealand, but I grow it here in the desert. You gotta establish it early, not during the summer, but it did last in the summer in a shaded spot. First year I've been able to keep it alive during the summer.
Mmm. Yeah, it doesn't taste like spinach.
Right.
No. Yeah. Well, you're expecting a spinach, but it's not spinach.
There's so many things called spinach, once again, that are just leaves you could eat raw.
Mm-hmm. It's a really cool flavor. Like, not really celery, but kind of had that. Maybe it's because I just had some. It has kind of like a subdued kind of minerally flavor, but really hydrating, like that the purple one too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Or that the other one, the aptinia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like that. Yeah. I mean, I have them growing kind of next to each other, so it's kind of fun. But the New Zealand spinach is very high in oxalates, so you're gonna get that kind of like minerally kind of thing. That's kind of like. Makes your mouth kind of like weird and stuff. So like, yeah, that's another one you don't want to eat a lot necessarily raw.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, I mean, unless you have a good population of oxalate digesting microbes in your gut, which is probably most Americans don't.
Yeah, exactly. Got to grow them slowly.
If you're from like sub-Saharan Africa and you eat a lot of wild foods, you probably got the bacteria to deal with those.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, so we got another one that I just saw right here. A lot of it didn't make it, but we got like a plant still kind of hanging out right here. Could probably grab a little bit of a few leaves off this, or a little baby sprig thing, like the center. So get a little bit. This definitely doesn't like when it gets too cold, so it's checking out, but at least you could try it for now.
Mm.
Is that enough of a taste?
Mm-hmm. And fresh. Light. I didn't really get any. Is it supposed to be peppery?
Nope, not
okay,
at all.
Yeah, because there's no peppery at all to it. But yeah, could you eat a salad of those? Because
absolutely,
could.
They do in Mexico.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh.
Vertilago or purslane. That's like a baby purslane leaf. Now, when they get bigger, they're a lot more like rich. But that was just like a little baby leaf that just happened to be still hanging in there.
That's cool. Because
the other stuff
never
just
had
dried out.
I've never had fresh purslane.
Yeah, it just grows. Oh, and then you get actually the stems are actually quite nice when they're fresh too, because they're just basically water-filled vessels. But yeah, I don't think I have any more hanging out, because that's kind of just hanging out from this summer.
Okay.
Oh, and I got, well, anyways, there's some more in that bit, but I got one more thing. So this is what I want to, this is another cool, this is another one of my, oh, you're going to get a baby leaf. So this is another one of my favorite plants. This is, we have the green tree collards you tried earlier, but this is actually the purple tree collards that doesn't take the heat as well.
Oh, okay.
Maybe, I don't know if I can shade that, because there's another guy in Vegas that grew a big one of these. It's 12 feet tall, and I was not able to do that. But I don't find it quite as tolerant, so maybe it's a little bit more difficult. But yeah, purple tree collard. See if you could taste the difference between that and the green one.
Mmm. Much more mild. Yeah, much more mild. A little more bitter. Oh, it's spicy.
Oh, it's, that one's spicy too, huh?
Mmm.
Mm, interesting. Yeah, this
is a little bit of a spice to it.
This is grown in the shade, but it did make it through the summer, and now it's going to really ramp up production in the wintertime. It just gets a lot sweeter. So during the summer, all the different brassica family plants that I keep alive, like the dino kale, the different tree collards, get all more spicy. In the winter, they get a lot more sweet, and the sugar gets into the plant to protect it from the cold, because sugars don't freeze as easily as water.
Hmm, interesting. Yeah, it's definitely not as strong as the other ones, but I do taste a little heat. Mm. Just like.
Yeah, but those are all the anti-cancer properties. Gotta make you anti-cancer, Lissa.
Ooh, anything chivey, I'm all in.
Yeah, no, I mean, you could totally just see, this is like, well, this is just more of a... So, let's see, what do I think that is? I just move everything in different places.
Oh my gosh, it's just so good.
Oh, all right, so that's probably just like standard bulb onion greens.
Yeah, I still like the Chinese one better.
On the younger side. Oh yeah, because those ones are way more mild.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, here's more Chinese chives right here. I mean, I was sitting on them. I have everything all spread out everywhere. If I want more chives, I got it right there.
Wow.
All right.
Yeah, so definitely delicious.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yeah, see, I mean, everything in my backyard is basically edible in one way or another. Many leaves, mostly leaves are edible, but I also have things like that make fruit and roots and tubers. So this is my amazing pepper bed. My biggest pepper plant is basically this guy. It's probably like 6 feet tall. You can see it's just loaded up with peppers even here in the desert. But below it, I tried to plant some understory plants to see like what would work and what wouldn't. So I spread seeds out like in between all the peppers of this guy, which is known as Surinam spinach or jewel of oak hair. And actually only the ones near the edge made it. Here's one right here, went to seed, but all the ones in the middle pretty much didn't make it, because I think they didn't get enough sun, but this one got enough sun. So you could try a jewel of oak hair leaf. This is one of my favorites actually. And this one is a weed and can take over easily.
Wow. Yeah, rubbery.
Yeah.
Mmm. Yep.
What does it taste like?
Like spinach, but not quite like spinach. It's really mild. It's got that
mucilaginous. Mm-hmm. It's kind of more succulently.
Mm-hmm. Succulent, definitely. Not as minerally, but it's so light that you could have more.
Yeah, you
of
could
it.
Have yeah. a lot of it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I wish I could grow. I need to grow more of it next year, and I'll have to figure out the right climate, you know, in the sun, like in my California. It would grow in the greenhouse, basically, I think most of the year, and just keep coming back every year, because these seed pods just break open, and then there's just a million little tiny seeds in each of these pods. Let me see if I could break one open here for you guys. Yeah, you can see all these little black seeds in there. I mean, they're so tiny. I'll just throw them out, and maybe next year I'll have some more of those. And then another plant that I just saw, this was not even planted by me, it just came up on its own. This one is known as mallow. This is more of a wild
mallow.
Food, edible mallow.
Mm. Mm. Creamy.
Yeah, that one's a really nice, mild
really
lettuce
super
substitute.
Super mild, yep. Yeah.
And you got a baby leaf too, so.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that was really good.
Oh, you like the mallow, huh?
I like the mallow.
Yeah, that's super easy to grow.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even think I planted them, and they just started coming in, but I did bring some special mallow, like purple mallow seeds that I'm going to grow next year. Anyways,
nice.
And then this plant, and this just comes up as a weed in my garden, would give you a small leaf, because they could have quite a pronounced effect on your mouth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm. Definitely one of my favorites. Whoa.
What are you tasting?
Spicy.
Like
hot
like hot peppers or like different, or
it's like hot pepper and bitter, but it's like really tingly hot. Whew. That's intense. That would be good. Wow.
That would be good. And that's just a small leaf. Yeah. I mean, imagine like some big leaves.
Wow.
Damn. And it's probably stronger now because it's going to seed. So when the plants go to seeds, like all the chemicals, phytochemicals get strong because the plant wants to protect itself because it wants to be able to go to seed and reproduce without animals eating it.
It's not like a hot that kind of goes up your nose kind of area. It stays in the mouth, but it almost is numbing in a way. But a hot numbing. I like this one though. That's one of my favorites.
That's cool. All right, now we get to go to the other side of the garden and see what else we got. Next plant I'm actually growing in a self-watering pot, and it's just right here amongst the larger water pepper. That's probably a lot stronger. But this guy right here is actually a cross between the tree collards and dinosaur kale.
Oh, I love dinosaur kale.
Yeah, so like, let's see, we'll give you a nice small little baby tender leaf there.
And definitely not as dark. I mean, the bottom ones are darker.
Yeah, well, this is this is all the summer damage. The plant didn't really like the summer. Now that it's cooling down, it's really loving it a lot more.
Mm.
And so it grows like a tree collard, but also it's perennial, but then it also is kind of like a dinosaur kale, so it's a mix.
Very much like a dinosaur kale, but more like, more satisfying, more minerally, definitely. And it's mild too, it's not too intense. But that's one reason why I like dinosaur kale, because it's not as like intense for me, as opposed to the curly kales.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was good.
Cool, and then right here we have just some fresh sage.
Ooh, sage. Standard sage. Sage. Mmm. Wow. Better than the store, that's for sure.
Like, yeah, the dried stuff, oh, wow. You just lose a lot of the flavor.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Yeah, it's an easy one to grow. And then you're touching rosemary, so grab a leaf off there.
Rosemary. Mm-hmm. Mmm. Herbally.
Yeah,
there's
just
so many flavors.
One leaf, it's like,
wow.
Boom.
Yeah, you don't need a lot. Whew.
Oh, and then right down here we have some thyme. So you got a little bit of thyme growing underneath there.
I got a little bit of thyme. Mmm. Yeah, definitely way stronger than like conventionally grown stuff. Like for sure, you can really taste the difference.
Yeah, flavors are just way more stronger. All right, here's another leaf. This is like a baby red vein sorrel leaf.
Sorrel.
Or bloody dock. Bloody dock leaf.
Ooh, mineral. Wow. More like a metallic.
Metallic, huh?
Mm-hmm. That one's metallic.
Let's see here. And this one is called, this one's actually done really good. This is the best year I've had for this plant. I really love it because it has like the purple stem on them. And this is actually known as Yomaji.
Yomaji.
I think it's like an Asian, like Japanese maybe, like green. So I've been eating a lot more of that since it's just, this is the first year it really took off and it's done well for me.
Mm-hmm. It's got like a really bright flavor. It would be good in a stir fry, really.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Minerally. Not bitter, but it's kind of got a sweet tone to it, too.
Mm. And then let's see, this leaf is actually going to be an unnamed leaf. Maybe I'll be able to look it up and find it, because actually I don't even remember the name. I plant all kinds of weird things, and there's probably some plant tag somewhere. But, let's see here. I know you could eat it raw, because otherwise no one bought it. All right. Looks like it's in like the celery family or something.
Yeah. Let's see.
I don't even know if there's a tag down here. I don't remember the name of that. I gotta look it up. I think it's a Japanese leafy green herb kind of thing.
It is very herbally. Very grounding. Mm-hmm. I can't even pinpoint that flavor. Wow.
It's just so different,
it's
right?
It's so different.
It's like nothing you've ever tasted.
You can't even describe it. Yeah. Totally different.
I can't even describe the name. Right? You hear all these weird things. All right, here's a nice tree here. Let's see if we can get a nice sprig off this plant here. Well, you're going to get a top growth here right off this plant.
Oh, look at this.
Just that little weird thing. Try that.
It's got little tiny, tiny, tiny flowers.
Yeah.
Mmm.
tastes like anything.
Oh my gosh. I can't pinpoint what it is. You gotta help me out.
Asparagus fern.
Asparagus.
Because asparagus will grow out small, and then you have like the little, you know, asparaguses to eat. And you could look down. If you see here, you could see kind of the asparagus stem.
Okay.
And then if you let them grow out, because they harvest them when they're young, if you let them grow out, this is what they grow into.
Really?
You could eat all the greens, but the greens and the leaves are like really kind of like, they normally look like this, and they don't really taste like much because there's not a lot to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But now it's going to flower. And probably gonna make some seeds, so you kind of got some of the leaves with the flowering seed things that are maybe a bit stronger.
Yeah, definitely asparagus. It's got that. Yeah, I always want to say satisfied because it's like meaty in a way, like thick and grounding. I was gonna say green beans, but it didn't really have like a green bean flavor.
All right, then we got these guys over here. This just kind of grows wild. I don't really do anything. Mostly just try not to pull it out too much. You guys that are watching probably know that have a lawn. You guys might have these in your lawn.
Clover!
Standard clover. Yeah.
Clover. I've never actually eaten a clover.
Oh, wow.
Whoa! Really lemony, bitter.
Yeah, it's another kind of oxalis. Like
super intense.
Even the just small leaf.
I didn't know.
Leaf.
Yeah. Huh. That's really intense. Burst of flavor.
Burst
like
of flavor.
Like a little candy.
Candy?
Mm-hmm.
Like lemon
without
candy?
Without being sweet. Yeah, like a lemon candy without being sweet. That was cool. I like that.
Eat it with some dates.
Yeah,
like,
totally.
Like, lemon
that
date candy.
So good. And just regular clover.
Yeah, huh. No, right. That's just common clover. It's just a weed. I don't even think I planted that. It just kind of came up on its own.
Wow. I'm learning so much today.
And trying so much. This side of the raised bed here, we have some parsley that grew through the summertime in the shade, and this is the curly parsley versus the flat leaf.
Mm-hmm. Mm. I like this one more than the flat leaf. It's sweeter.
Yeah, I definitely will. Yeah, this is also probably a lot in the shade, so it's like more mellow, more mild, and I personally prefer the curly parsley. Mm-hmm. I like the texture of it a little bit better than the flat leaf.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I grew flat leaf 1 year because I couldn't get the curly. And then it just went to seed, and then they just come up anywhere. And I'll eat whatever. I don't really care, but I prefer the curly leaf. It's just so much better to me.
Yeah, it's definitely good.
And then right behind me here, we have one that I've been trying to grow for a while. This is known as go-to cola. It's just growing in a pot underneath my bele tree, another one of those. And you could try a leaf of these. This is known as, this is good for your brain. It's like brain, and if you go to the health food store, they'll sell you go-to cola pills.
Mm-hmm.
But why eat pills when you could have it fresh?
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
And that's a unique flavor as
very
well.
Very unique flavor.
I love
flavor.
That flavor.
Can't even describe it, but it's quite fibrous too. Mm-hmm. Like a thicker green, but can't describe that one.
Yeah.
You gotta grow your own.
It's one of my favorite flavors. Over here, you guys can see I have a whole bunch of aloes in the pot. And normally, when harvesting aloes, I'll harvest the nice, large, succulent leaves. These have done really well for me. Finally, they're taking off after many years. This is a special cultivar known as the aloe vera Miller Stockton, which is supposed to be probably the most medicinal variety that I was told. But for Lissa here, we're not going to harvest a big leaf, but we're just going to harvest, like, seriously little baby leaf. You would never really want to do this because it could damage the plant. But, yeah, we're going to see how this tastes to her.
Cool. And just the whole thing?
The whole thing. It's all edible.
Ooh.
I wouldn't harvest big leaves and eat them. Normally, you strip off the outside, but the baby ones probably have less of the, I don't know, want to say toxin, but chemicals. So how does it taste to you?
It's like really nice, like a grape, obviously, because it's
so
aloe.
It's really watery.
Really watery.
And jelly.
Really watery. Yeah, it's not as jelly as I thought it would be, probably because it's a baby.
It's a baby,
but
it's so baby.
It does have it. It is bitter.
Bitter, mm-hmm. Strong bitter, or a little.
It moderate, I would say.
Yeah, the bigger leaves would get more bitter, but like right under the skin, there's this yellow sap that if you eat too many of them, you will be on the toilet. But I mean, you just had a little small piece. So normally they take those out. In my other variety I have grown in California called the Japanese aloe, that bitterness is basically bred out of the plant.
Oh wow, interesting.
So then you can't eat the leaves, and they're basically not very little bitter, mm-hmm. but you could eat like those with the skin on. Normally you should remove the skin. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you could actually at least have that experience of eating a little baby bitter. Fresh baby. Aloe.
It was good.
The bitterness could be a healthy thing if you don't eat too much of it, actually, mm-hmm. also. So you guys can see all this beautiful mustard spinach, or also called komatsuna. Another green. Have you ever had komatsuna?
I have not.
Yeah, so it's like a Japanese kind of green, and it's just like one of my favorite things. They grow really fast. The plants are just so amazing.
Anything with mustard has my attention.
Yeah, so let's see. We'll harvest one of these. This is an outer leaf this time. It kind of got broken. Even if it's organic, guys. No pesticide.
No pesticides. Mmm. Mmm.
What did that taste like?
It's super mild. Whoa. It was mild at first. And then you get a little bit of that.
The kick. The mustard kick.
The mustard kick. But it's not as strong as I thought it would be. But it's just enough to have, you could have a salad.
You could have a salad of that, absolutely. And of course, you know, in Asian cultures, a lot of the mustard greens are cooked and then basically the heat dissipates.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Definitely.
But I really like the texture of this because it's kind of like, you know, really, it's like kind of like a bok choy, kind of mm-hmm. like really tender.
Tender, yep, chewy, but not fibrous.
Right, exactly, not fibrous. Mm-hmm. I like that. Yeah, it really makes for good juice when they get larger too.
So good. And I like that one.
I planted them in the shade because otherwise they might bolt fast. This next bed will get kind of pulled out soon. It basically had a lot of purple basil that's kind of went the way of the west. It dried out, gotten too cold. But we also have my Briton shiso, which is green on the top and purple on the bottom. And you can try a little baby leaf. The plant is going to flower right now, so it will be a little bit stronger.
Ooh, nice and small.
Yeah.
Just enough. Mmm, licorice-y, peppery. Ooh, that's, yeah.
Then you get a little bit of mm-hmm. kick. Mm-hmm.
I like the licorice-ness to it. That's very nice.
What does it taste like to you? Any other herbs you've had so far?
I have tasted it.
Yeah, you've tasted it before.
In the garden, yep. Yeah. But I can't pinpoint which one it was.
Yeah, so this is kind of closely related to like the mint and basil family.
Mm, yes,
so I'd
definitely.
Say it kind of has like a basil, not exactly minty flavor, but it's kind of like the similar kind of like that heat kind of thing like the Italian basil has.
Yes,
but different.
Definitely.
It's totally different.
Yeah, I know. It's hard to.
It's hard to
it's
hard to
kinda
say.
Kind of like that, but then it's not really.
Right. This plant's still hanging out back down here. We got purple basil. I think this is like red rose basil.
Purple basil. Look how pretty that is.
You could compare the flavors of this to the other basils.
Mmm. That's a more mild basil.
Well, that one's also mm-hmm. grown in the shade, so maybe we'll you can try another one that's grown in the sun so we could see. But that one, this is my favorite because it's purple, and I just tend to dominate and eat mostly that one.
Yeah, that one's really good.
This side, we got a whole bed of mint. This bed just takes over everything, so I don't really even try to do anything else. Just kind of like standard peppermint. But as you can see, I have like mint for days to make smoothies or juice or whatever I want, like all summer.
That's good.
Yeah, I love this stuff so much. Like
mint.
So much, just all mint. Mm-hmm. Mint banana smoothies, yeah, mint in the juice.
Definitely, I like that one.
And this bed is looking kind of jacked up because I literally just planted it last night, but we will snag a leaf here for you. This is just my arugula planting that I'm growing for the winter season.
Mmm, wow.
Fresh arugula.
I like arugula, but I normally can't eat too much of it just because the flavor can be
too strong,
but this one
is mild.
It's way more mild.
That's because it's a baby right now, but if you let it mm-hmm. you let it grow a little while and the leaves get more mature, then they get a lot stronger.
Mm-hmm. That's good. I like that.
Oh good. Mm-hmm. So I have like these pots in between my raised beds, and there's a few things growing. These are really nice tender leaves right here. Baby
Ooh.
Leaf, you know what that is?
That's dandelion.
Yeah, dandelion.
Mm-hmm. Dandelion's always a good one. Nice, because they weren't mature, so they weren't too intense.
All right, and then this is another kind of mint. I don't remember the name, but it's a lot more furry than just my standard mint, and the leaves are kind of more like an arrow.
Yeah, much more furrier. A lot more mild.
Mild flavor.
Mm-hmm. Mild flavor. Not as intense minty, like it's not as cold. Mm. More like a green. Kind of like if you had one of those with like some other greens.
Oh, like mixed together to balance it out?
Yeah.
Behind me here, this is, I'm just planting these out today actually, but we'll snag you
bok choy.
We'll snag you a leaf here that's kind of, this is a bok choy or pak choy. Little baby leaf.
Oh my gosh. Better than the store for sure.
Oh yeah, I mean that's a little baby leaf. They never harvest that young.
So good, because like you said, we don't normally eat that kind, the
you
babies.
Yeah, you don't get to eat fresh stuff. Mm-hmm. But when you grow them, I mean, once these are planted and even just grow a week or two, they're gonna get bigger. I can harvest all the little baby leaves to eat, and that's what I'm eating.
Very hydrating too.
Yeah, I really love the stems. Mm-hmm. Like I use the stems instead of celery to make like juice. It's really watery.
Yeah, so good.
And then behind it here, we have just another tree collard cross, which I don't even know their variety. So it's like a tree collard cross with one of my other brassicas I grew in the summertime. And so let's see here, we'll probably pick. I've been juicing these leaves as they get older. I usually don't harvest the center leaves too much, but here's another center leaf, or probably another cross.
Another
tree collard cross. That was born here.
Very fibrous.
Yeah, this one's more fibrous. That's why I tend to juice the large leaves.
Ooh, that's got quite a strong flavor.
Yeah, well, this is in direct full sun through the entire summer.
Yeah, that's good.
So it really makes my juice taste strong.
It's interesting how plants can taste different depending on where they grow.
Yeah, the location plus the varieties. I mean, this is a little bit different variety than the other collards because, I mean, this is just from seed that came up when it cross-pollinated.
That's cool.
So I don't really differentiate to me. It's just like all collard greens, all kale, they all have like the same nutrition, like anti-cancer, cleansing, detoxificating, all these crazy things.
It's good stuff.
So this next bed is my purple basil grown in full sun in the summertime. So some of the plants are getting jacked up, but when they're more in the sun, they get more purple and I think more stronger tasting, but you could tell me what you think.
Yeah, definitely stronger.
Than that other one that was in the shade.
And more minerally, more bitter.
Yeah, so this is the stuff I normally been harvesting off of, because it's more minerally, more bitter, and that has more phytochemicals for anti-disease promotion. So these are my baby plants that I'm putting in for the winter time. I'll have a tour video where I go over all these, but this is like red borer or scarlet kale. That's I think the one you tried already, scarlet borer, the big one. That was big, but these will taste different because they're babies. But you've already tried that one, so we're gonna try this guy. But this is just basically baby cilantro.
Yes!
So it's not microgreen cilantro, but it's baby cilantro. Isn't it? It's like my favorite.
Oh my gosh. Wow. I used to not be a cilantro person because it would taste like soap. But now I can eat it and it doesn't taste like soap, which is really interesting.
Interesting. Yeah, and how does that compare to the store, like fresh versus the store stuff?
Oh, this is way better.
Like stronger, like milder?
I would say it's milder, but in a more minerally way. Because the store-bought one is almost like intense right away, whereas this one has more substance. Like it's almost, I can taste more.
Like depth, more flavor.
There's more depth.
Depth,
yeah, to this one than a store-bought cilantro, for sure.
More plant starts, and actually this year, we got a couple new things, so we got pluck off one of these outer leaves for you. This is the red Russian kale. Once again, baby red Russian kale. So you could probably buy the red Russian kale like the mature stuff, but this is like baby.
That's good.
And now this is even a more rare one. This is the first time I'm growing this, and this is supposed to be like one of the best kales, supposedly.
Really?
This is known as Casper, like Casper the Friendly Ghost, Casper kale. Tell me what you think of that one.
Oh wow, it's not very strong, like way more mild.
Exactly.
Because normally a kale is like intense, boom. Right? Whereas this one is more like, I want to say spinach, but it's not strong like a spinach, but it's more creamier, not as rough, not as fibrous. Could definitely eat a bigger salad with those than as opposed to some of the other ones, especially the curly kale.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what the plant description said, you know, online in the seed catalog. It said, you know, like mild sweet kale. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, I'm there.
Sweet kale, for sure.
Yeah, sweet kale. All right, so then here we got, this is actually orange balm. So they have like lemon balm, but this is actually orange balm. So like another herb.
Super fuzzy.
Yeah, super fuzzy.
I love the fuzzy ones. Mmm. You can taste a little hint of orange. It's definitely not like lemon balm. It's more like a, more herbally, a little orangey. It's good, it's good.
And then see back here we got za'atar oregano. So you probably use za'atar, like oregano, like spice or something.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually the za'atar oregano plant.
Oh, that's oregano. Yep. That's good. Mmm. I like a fresh oregano too, more so than dried.
Mm.
It's so much more flavorful. Mmm.
And then this is a new one I'm growing this year. I'm really excited to get it because I've been wanting to grow this for a while. This is known as Gynostemma pentaphyllum or jiglilwan. It's actually in China, it's known as the immortality herb.
Really?
It's so disease preventing, and hopefully this stuff just takes over my garden. And actually, I don't even think I tasted the fresh leaves yet because I just got the plants.
Super unique.
Yeah, what does that taste like?
I don't want to say cabbage, but it's got a licorice flavor to it too.
Bitter at all?
Bitter. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, I can't even pinpoint that one.
Yeah, I haven't tasted it yet myself actually, but it's in the curbit family, so it's actually related to cucumbers, which is weird.
Really?
But you eat the greens. Yeah, I mean, they turn into powders and all kinds of crazy stuff.
I would have never guessed cucumber, for sure. I see you have some garlic here, too.
Oh, yeah, you want to try it? This is actually purple garlic, Italian. So you can try
Italian purple garlic.
Try a more mature leaf here. Sacrifice. Well, maybe just the end.
Just the end.
Just a tip. Yeah, so purple Italian garlic leaf baby.
Baby.
Baby. So tender, delicious.
Big fan of garlic. Oh my god.
Isn't it just like boom in your mouth, baby?
Wow. Yep. Strong, that's probably one
right?
of my favorite things.
Is it strong?
It's or actually mild? Not too strong. It's decent enough that you could add to a salad and not have it overpowering. And great for people who have issues with the straight garlic bulb.
Yeah, because it's way more mild.
Yeah, way more mild, and it's a green, so that was good.
Actually, you guys should start to grow that, because that's an easy one to grow indoors. You could just take your bulbs or the cloves when they're sprouting and just grow them under lights, and then you could harvest all the greens. And actually, the greens of onions and garlic are actually more nutritious in terms of antioxidant content than the bulbs themselves.
Good to know.
All right, next we got some cauliflower. So I'm growing rainbow cauliflower.
Rainbow!
They're gonna turn out purple, green, and yellow, and orange.
Nice.
But you're gonna get to try a baby cauliflower leaf. I think it's sad how, you know, you go to the store, you could buy cauliflower to eat, but you really can't buy cauliflower greens. You really gotta be a gardener to grow them or know a farmer that's just gonna say the greens, because most of the time farmers harvest the cauliflower and all the greens will just go to waste.
Tastier than cauliflower.
Yeah, I prefer the cauliflower greens than the cauliflower itself, myself.
Those are good.
Yeah, like sweet, right?
Mm-hmm. Very sweet, very mild. They don't really taste like cauliflower, though.
No, they don't.
No, they're more of a, more just a natural.
Like a kale or a collard green, yeah.
Ooh, that's good.
All right, cool. And then the next one we got, this is a creeping thyme. I don't know what kind of thyme you had before, but maybe that was a common thyme. This is a creeping thyme.
I like this one better.
Tastes different, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we got, I don't know, what's this guy? Sweet marjoram. Marjoram, whatever it is.
Marjoram. Thanksgiving.
It's coming up.
That's what it tastes like to me.
And then we got Cascadia lemonade thyme.
Lemon thyme.
So it sounded really cool to me, like, okay, lemonade thyme. All right, I hope it's gonna be sweet.
Right? Mmm, it is.
It's sweet?
It's a little sweeter.
All right, I haven't tried bitter. Anything yet, but I'll have to try it.
It is definitely, because you know how thyme has that like really groundy, bittery flavor?
Oh yeah, it's actually like, quite upbeat.
Yeah, like, upbeat, yeah, like.
Wow.
Bright.
I could just soak some of that like in my shirt cane juice and it'd be like, whoa.
Mmm, that would be good.
Yeah, wow, cool. Mm. These are on sale at the local nursery right now because they're clearing some out for the winter.
So, that's awesome.
And then here we got, oh, this is an interesting one. This is called citronella balm.
Hey, it's my name. It's Melissa.
It's called Melissa?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, Melissa officinalis. This is the official Melissa plant. All right, here.
That's so cool. I always love that my name was Melissa because it's lemon balm.
Citronella balm.
Yes, very citronella-y. Mm. Mm-hmm. Not as lemony as some of the other stuff that we tasted, but this one's really nice. It's more mild lemon flavor. Mm.
Mm-hmm. Last thing that I'm planting for this winter time. Kind of getting beat up in the wind here. This is actually purple Brussels sprouts.
Ooh, purple Brussels sprouts.
Well, or actually red Brussels sprouts. Red Bull Brussels sprouts, and these are the leaves. And I think it's sad how most people just get the Brussels sprouts, eat the Brussels, but I just eat the leaves actually. I don't even want the Brussels personally.
Look at that. Okay.
Once again, baby leaf, of course.
Mild, minerally, not bitter. Very nice, actually. Way better than Brussels, you're right.
Yeah, no, way better.
It's like the cauliflower. I'd rather have the greens than the actual, which is, like you said, a shame that we don't have this in the grocery store.
Yeah, and the greens also more nutritious than the flowers, or the greens of the Brussels are probably more nutritious than the sprouts themselves on some levels. On other levels, probably the Brussels sprouts are better, but.
But yeah, it's a shame that they just throw it away.
Yeah.
Or compost it or whatever they do. But they could be selling it and we could be eating it.
Yeah, but people buy what they buy. They buy cauliflower, they don't buy cauliflower greens. So once again, a good reason to grow your own garden. You guys can see the diversity I'm literally growing. Like so many things, literally money can't buy. Next plant, I just have it actually growing underneath my water spigot when my water spigot used to drip before I fixed it because it likes to stay moist. And now I just put a dripper on it. This is actually known as pennywort. And it just stays alive right here, like in the shade, because it's like right against the house and then really never gets any direct sun. But it really loves this environment. You can see it's just so filled in. This is another more wild food, or they would actually eat it in Asia. So we could get you a little baby leaf here.
Mm. They're really cool how they grow.
Yeah, I love them. It's like kind of like a round little leaf thing.
Mmm. Very mineral dense. Bitter.
Bitter.
Mm-hmm. That is a bitter one. But it's good. And I like bitter stuff too, so I'm finding this really enjoyable.
Yeah, that's why she's doing the taste test. Like, ew, it's bitter, it's nasty. We need to appreciate bitters, guys. I mean, if you don't like bitters, like I have a friend that's like a raw foodist and you're like, you're trying to poison me, John, with these bitter things. Like, bitter things are quite detoxifying. Not that we should like eat all these bitter things, but man, we should get some variety in our diets and eat some bitter things sometimes. Like, with this plant, I won't make a salad out of it, but you know, surely when I'm harvesting my lettuce, she'll get the taste in a second. I'll pick a couple of these leaves. And actually what I do when I make a salad is I'll go around my garden, pick a leaf of this, a leaf of that, just kind of like she's doing. And I'll have like a hodgepodge of all these different crazy flavors and nutrients and microbiome enhancing fibers in my diet. And I want you guys to do that too. That's why Growing Your Greens is the name of my YouTube channel. I want you guys to grow and eat your greens. They are amazing and there are so many and they're so easy to grow. So next, check this out. Baby lettuces I literally just planted probably a couple weeks ago. They're really doing nice. You're gonna get to try two unique varieties. This curly one is known as Lola Rosa lettuce and it turns really red in the sun once it gets more sun to it and they get a little bit larger. And this one is called Red Sails. And these are also red tinged. So I want to encourage you guys, I've said this before, but we want to eat open head lettuces. Why do we want open head lettuces instead of closed head lettuces? They get more sun. So the more sun that hits the lettuce, the more nutrients can be made, the more plant protection and phytochemicals are created because the plant is getting more exposed to the sun. It's kind of like, you know, if we're out in the sun more, we could burn more unless we have the protection. And the closed heads don't have all the different solar panels literally to collect the sun energy, convert it through photosynthesis into nutrients. So let's see, we're gonna go ahead and pick you off a nice leaf of the red sales lettuce here.
I'm excited.
That's a little bit old.
Right. B12 from the dirt.
Yeah. So red sales leaf red is sales. The freshest lettuce you've ever had.
Wow. Let's just get a little bit off here. Mm. All right. Mmm.
How does that compare to store-bought stuff?
Way better. Way better. Got way much more flavor.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Like totally. I mean, I think that's like the minerals in the soil. It's just being picked fresh, like not transported. Like it just, and it's baby. It's young, right? Mm-hmm. In the store, you don't get to choose. They harvest whole heads when they're kind of more mature. Mm-hmm. Like if I want a salad, I go around and pick one leaf off every plant. And yeah, I could do that because I have like over 100 lettuce plants and I have 100 leaf lettuce salad easily. And it just blows me away how good it tastes that people just like,
you
oh,
don't
just
even need a salad dressing, really.
I know, no. I'll just come out here and eat lettuce and just eat a leaf of this. And when I harvest them like, oh, these are touching. They're kind of like shading the next guy out. I'll harvest the big leaves. So I'm kind of doing a favor. Then they're thinking, I just got picked. I better grow faster. So they respond like, we build muscles by working them. Yeah. The plants respond like, I just got picked. I better grow faster. Then I can just eat more of you. All right, grow guys, grow. I love you guys. All right.
They're awesome.
All right, so next one is we're gonna get to eat a baby Lola Rosa lettuce. This is my favorite because they really get red. I could show you some more mature ones actually. Mm. Over there, maybe you could try that. So you could taste the difference between mature Lola Rosa versus like baby Lola Rosa.
That's more bitter.
More bitter.
Much more bitter.
Yeah, more nutritious, more bitter. Nutritious.
I know, it's almost like it's bitter, it's good.
Well, that's what I like, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's like my favorite one I'm growing.
But a lot of greens, like endive, for example, used to be so bitter in the past, but they've kind of bred it out. So it's not as bitter as it used to be in the past because people don't tend to like the bitter.
Bitters.
So in order to sell more, they've bred it. The bitterness out of a lot of things.
Or just also the way it's grown. So like my celery is way stronger.
Right.
And you know, maybe they might grow the different practices or different varieties to make it, you know, sometimes I know they like cover celery so it doesn't get as much sun. Mm-hmm. So they're kind of more pale instead of green. And then maybe they're not as strong either because the public doesn't like strong tasting celery. Like if they sold celery like the stuff I grow,
yeah, like, they wouldn't sell very
people
much.
Wouldn't buy it, maybe unless you're from Italy and you like bitter stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
So this is my green onions, but they're baby green onions that literally I just planted. So we'll pick you off a nice little sprig here.
My absolute favorite green onions. So fresh, so light. Just enough flavor to not be overpowering. Delicious. Yeah. This is like, aside from the garlics and the other, this is actually, I like this better than the Chinese one now.
Oh, wow.
These are good.
Yeah, well, and the cool thing is, you know, there's 36 of these bunches in here. If I just like come and harvest a whole bunch like this, I have a whole bunch to eat. And then it'll grow back, and then I have 36 other ones to do that. So,
you could do one
I could
day.
Always rotate. Right now, I'm kind of letting them get established because I literally just planted them like maybe, I don't know, 2-3 weeks ago. But yeah, I like how they look. They just look really cool,
they're so
you know.
Cool.
Mm. I love the texture. It's fun. And then here, we're not going to try these because you already tried this. This is the Lola Rosa that you already tried. But these are getting a lot more red as they get a little bit more mature and older. Because this was planted, you know, before the ones you sampled earlier. This next bed is my red Mizuna. I really love the deep colors on this Mizuna. Beautiful. Mizuna is another Asian leafy green. These were literally just planted like 3 days ago.
I'm excited for this one because I know what
that's super baby.
Yeah, not as intense as the mature, obviously, but that's good. It's like It doesn't even have that mustardy flavor.
Yeah, they pretty much kind of bred it out. Yeah, and usually the Mizunas don't even get that strong. Like I could eat a salad out of these guys.
Definitely. That's good.
Yeah, the problem with the Mizunas is that they bolt pretty fast. So you gotta use them, they bolt, and then, you know, I'm gonna replace them with something else. But I like things that kind of grow different, you know, levels. So I'm always like, oh, I gotta pull this bed and replant it. And it's not happening to like five of my same beds at the same time. And of course, right behind me, we have the classic dinosaur kale that you haven't gotten to eat yet. As you guys can see, I had some major issues with some caterpillar things that I controlled without spraying. I would come by and just shake each plant vigorously, and what would happen is they would detach and then land on the ground, and then I would deal with them individually. That way I didn't have to spray anything on these plants. Nice. But let's see, so you might get a...
But they did get to them.
They did get some, yeah, they do have some holes. So it's like Swiss cheese dinosaur kale. But that's all right, I don't really mind the holes. I'd rather have them non-sprayed.
Exactly.
But yeah, baby dinosaur greens.
So good. Yep, that's good stuff.
My favorite
kale.
Is that your favorite kale so far? Even over the Casper? The baby Casper kale?
That one was good. That one was good. There's so many favorites.
All right, and then right behind you, we'll grab a leaf of that. Maybe you stay there.
Okay.
This is actually like a, I'm pretty sure it's a kohlrabi crossed with a tree collard, because it's like growing a kohlrabi thing, but it's like a tree collard. Really weird. And it made it through the summer.
Very mild, but bitter. Like, it's not super strong, but it's more creamy. I like to say the creamy. Well, that's a good one.
I guess you could try this one. These technically are edible. They're right above you, and we'll pick you a small leaf. This is a fig leaf. Fig leaves are edible. I don't know that you'd want to eat a ton of them.
They're really rough.
Yeah, that's why. And you got a baby, and that'll be a unique flavor.
Wow. Cinnamony.
Yep.
Yep. That's interesting. Yeah, definitely cinnamon bark. Bark, really rough. But that was cool. I didn't know that they had a cinnamon flavor.
Yeah, and then let's see, we could try, I don't know if you could try one of these, or lemongrass. But that's gonna be really, I don't even know if there's any baby leaves. I think they're all like really too mature to eat, actually, and they'll probably cut your tongue. Yeah, let's see, this is like, oh, this is kind of, oh, we could try a little small piece of this. This is more of a, this is a softer, gentler lemongrass leaf.
Lemongrass leaf.
Top, yeah, but still really fibrous.
Very fibrous, but beautiful flavor. Lemon flavor. Beautiful lemon flavor.
You have a lot of things that are lemony. Oh, yeah, there's another one right here, I forgot.
Ooh, that's good. It smells good, too.
I think this one is actually the true lemon balm. I don't think you have this yet. You had like orange balm and citronella balm, and that's my lemon balm I think I have growing.
Oh yeah.
Is it lemon balm?
Mm-hmm.
All right, cool.
It is citronella-y too.
Yeah, because I don't remember I planted it and then I never really labeled it, and it just keeps coming back every year. All these weird things where I know where they are in my garden. So along the back we have Malabar spinach. It's kind of on its way out because it's been getting colder, so you can see it's not quite as like deep green as it once was, but if you can maybe go to the bottom, we can still find some leaves that are like more green.
These are so cool.
Yeah, and those are like the little flowers that are forming. And then the flowers form into these little fruits that are purple here. We're not doing a fruit tasting, but yeah, I use these fruits to basically make like a juice, like purple fruit juice.
Wow.
They're totally not sweet at all, and they actually have beta-cyanins, which is like, I haven't seen that too much.
Interesting. They almost remind me of a Hoya flowers.
I don't know. That's a non-edible plant,
no,
right? If it's not an edible plant, I pretty much don't know what it is.
But they have like that like almost rubbery like look to them. Very interesting.
Yeah, I love the flowers.
Oh. Mucilaginous again.
Yeah, very mucilaginous.
Yeah, whoa.
Boom in your mouth.
Wow. It's like super sticky, but not sticky, like, wow.
Bitter, sweet, neutral.
Mild, neutral.
Yeah, mild.
Mild.
Just mucilaginous, neutral, yeah.
Yep, totally.
So that's another nice summer green to eat, you know, grows really well. In Florida, Hawaii, you know, the leaves get really large and you can grow them all year pretty much.
Wow.
And then here is we have actually summer grown, it grew through the summer without bolting, which is amazing, my arugula.
I grew
arugula here last year. They dropped the seeds and these seeds just sprouted up on their own without me even planting them. So now I just have all this arugula to grow. So this is like mature arugula. Look how long those stems
are.
Wow. So it tastes a little bit different than the mild stuff I literally just planted.
And this one's also called Rocket too, right?
Yeah, Rocket, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. That's, wow.
So is that more powerful than the baby, obviously?
Way,
and
wow.
And it's really kicking your butt in your mouth?
It gets to that point.
Where you're just like, whoop.
You're chewing it and you're like, okay, that's cool. And then all of a sudden, woo, that's intense. Yeah, this is good. I actually really like the flavor.
Oh, good. Yeah, I've been putting this stuff, like I made a microgreen salad with like lettuce, and then I'll put a bunch of these in there to like kick it up a level.
It's almost like super sweet and then super spicy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's got two phases to
now,
it.
Do you get that in store-bought, like arugula? You just get the super spicy, right? Not really the
sweet. Yeah, not the sweet. You don't get the sweet. Because normally that's why I said, like when I make a salad with arugula, I don't put as much in. Because it's
just
so intense.
Super spicy. But this is sweet and spicy.
Sweet and spicy. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, my opinion on the sweet stuff is actually, you know, we have mineral detectors in our tongues. And when we're detecting sweet, this is, I mean, maybe a little bit of sugar in there, you know, from the plants. Mm-hmm. But it's not really even getting that cold yet for it to make a lot of sugar.
Whew.
But it's really the minerals that we're tasting, and it's really lighting up our mineral taste buds that we maybe identify as sweet.
Interesting,
That's why, I mean, that's why I add a lot of trace minerals to my garden to make sure I'm going to have the sweetest, best-tasting, most nutritious plants that taste better to me than the store.
Agreed. Better than the store.
And it's not just, I mean, if you grow your stuff at home, it's always going to be better than the store. But you could even up your game by using some of the different soil amendments that I recommend in my videos. You know, I think that's why I get better tasting, because I've tasted a lot of people's stuff in their gardens. And like, it's rare that I find gardens that taste better than mine. All right, so here's another one. These ones I've been harvesting, you can see them, I've been cutting them back.
Yeah.
These are just more mature green onions that I, you know, grew, obviously. Oh, versus like the baby ones you just tried.
Yeah. Mild right now. I'm waiting. Actually, not too bad.
They stayed mild. Yeah, these
That's
stayed
really
mild
cool.
Even in the full sun of the summer. These grew all through the summer because I planted them before the summer, and I just been harvesting back. And to me, they don't really even taste like onions. They just they're just some crunchy stuff. So I made a pizza and I put these on the pizza as the topping, like in mass, like a lot, and it wasn't really even that spicy.
Yeah, that was really good. Because normally the green onions at the store are so intense at sometimes you can't have as many of them. But this is a lot sweeter, a lot more mild. You could add a lot more.
Yeah, and I have no idea why that is. Just because I grew it and it's better. So the next bed we got here, just planted out, I don't know, probably about a month ago or so. This is the bull's blood beets. And not only will it make the beets under the ground, but it also makes nice, deep, rich, red leaves you guys could eat. So there's a nice red leaf. I try to grow a lot of things that are red for different colors and more nutrition.
It's beautiful in the sunlight too.
Yeah.
Gorgeous.
Baby beet greens.
It does have that beet kind of reminiscence.
Or tastes like Swiss chard maybe.
Mm-hmm. Minerally.
Yep.
It's cool because you can taste all of those minerals. But definitely, again, I do love beets though. So, as much as I love cauliflower, I do like the cauliflower greens better than cauliflower. But with the beets, I would say I like them both equal, the greens and the beets.
Yeah, I prefer the beet greens just because they're more nutritious. And I get to eat them like for a long time. You harvest the beet and you eat the beet root, it's gone.
It's gone.
But as a gardener, when I just grow the greens, I just pick a leaf off and I still make the root at the end of the season. So.
Yeah, exactly. That's awesome. Very tasty.
So we got another bed of lettuce, and while this bed may look like the other one where we had Lola Rosa and red sails, this one actually has Lola Rosa, which is a bit more mature because it's more red, but it has actually new red fire lettuce. So this
red
is a little
fire.
Bit, little bit different cultivar, a little bit more mature. So this is the new red fire lettuce.
Interesting. All right, let's see what this one's like. mild.
Mild?
I'm surprised, because I expected it to be a lot more bitter, just like from the initial bite, but very mild. You could easily eat a lot of that.
Yeah, I mean, that's my salad. And then I have, I only got like 1 6-pack this year of this leaf, and I think this is just like red salad bowl lettuce was the name that was called last year. And actually, this was a really good performer for me in my garden last year, so they just kind of look more, to me, decorative, but they're still red. Mm.
Yeah, they are really pretty. It is so pretty when you make a salad with like so many different kinds of things.
Right.
Just like the colors, we love that too. Mm. That's a good one too.
So what?
Very neutral. A little bit bitter. Actually, the other one was bitter, the fire one.
So now she gets to try standard spinach. I literally planted this literally like 4 or 5 days ago. This is called the Melody spinach. So this is just a standard spinach that Americans would know. I mean, you try to have a lot of other spinaches. And let's go ahead and harvest this leaf for you here. So once again, baby spinach. To me, this stuff tastes like so much better than the stupid stuff you get at the store, like in the big bulk 1 pound tote. It's like the ones in the tote just taste nasty to me.
Wow. I normally don't eat spinach.
Really? Why?
Because
it's too chalky,
don't
tastes
really
nasty.
I like it. But this I could get behind. It's so bold, but mild at the same time.
And it's not like, it doesn't taste chalky and like, just, it has like a good texture. Like the stuff in the store is like wilty, kind of like mush.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like kind of crisp and just like flavorful and like vibrant.
Honestly, if you didn't tell me this was spinach, I would have never guessed.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Never, ever have guessed. It's like nutty and creamy.
Yeah. I've been telling everybody for like ever, growing your own stuff is like the best. And nobody gets it.
I never would have guessed spinach in a million years.
Yeah, I can barely buy spinach at the store. I tell you guys, after growing it, and I usually try to plant like a couple beds of spinach, but it's hard to get the plant starts for me.
Mm.
But like homegrown spinach is like, I mean, one negative thing is that it grows very slow compared to my other greens that I'm growing.
Mm.
But it tastes so much better than the store-bought stuff. Like, I wish you guys were here to try it.
I know.
Sorry, I can't give every one of you guys a personal tour like Lissa, but I'm making one with her so you guys could experience it without being here.
Mm-hmm. Almost like it was dipped in a dressing. Like a creamier dressing. I don't even have words to describe.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of times I just go around my garden, just pick and eat leaves. Like I'll just forage on my garden like a deer in the forest.
Having a whole salad just from the garden.
Because it tastes so good without even, you don't even need a dressing. Like why do we have dressings? Because we have food that doesn't taste good because it's not being grown appropriately, being shipped and stored and harvested when it's too mature and all this stuff.
Yeah, and also being a chef, like a lot of the stuff that I've tasted was like, I could make the coolest different like salads and dressings and I could get really creative, but it's hard because unless you grow it yourself.
If you have good flavorful stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, the extra flavor takes it up a notch.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody really gets to try a lot of the stuff I make, but
exactly.
I mean, it just tastes amazing because I'm using such high quality ingredients.
Yeah. You gotta do it, guys. Start growing your own spinach because it's next level.
So behind my spinach, I have this little pot here, and I encourage you guys, if you're gonna grow mint, grow it in pots. And actually, this is my favorite mint in my whole entire garden. This is the chocolate mint.
Chocolate mint.
Yeah, have you had chocolate mint before?
I have not.
No way.
No,
oh my gosh, you're missing out.
Living in Canada, it's hard to get stuff and grow stuff.
Fresh.
Wow.
That's like my favorite.
Wow. Oh my gosh, you can totally tell. It's kind of like in Canada, we had something called After Eight mints.
Mm.
Kind of like
like candies?
Like, yeah, it's like mint in the inside and then chocolate on the
outside.
Oh
yeah, we got those here. Yeah. Like they give them at restaurants when you're done, usually sometimes for free or.
Mm-hmm. It's not as obviously not like chocolate,
but
it's got that hint.
Flavor.
Yeah, that hint of chocolate grounding. Minty, perfect. I agree. That's my favorite.
So in another container, I have some random things growing, including more onions. But you've tried kind of these onions. I have some catnip in the back, but I wanted you could taste one of these guys. And this is actually more of the wild arugula. So like this one comes back every year. It's really not doing too good this year.
Ooh. The leaves are really thin.
And the leaves are really thin and small. And I mean, if it's like a brand new fresh planting, they might be bigger, but this makes a lot smaller leaves, but they have a really unique flavor. Once again, this plant's not doing the best, but this is probably the third year it's come back on its own without me replanting.
Very sweet.
Oh, that's sweet today.
Very sweet.
Because normally, like, it's really spicy.
Really?
Yeah.
It hasn't hit yet, but.
I'm amazed. All right.
Also,
they're very baby underdeveloped leaves, too, so maybe that's why.
That's good.
All right, cool. And then moving on to my herb bed right behind me, you can see I just literally have a wall of oregano. This is the oregano that I grow majority. It just takes over. This is my hot and spicy oregano, and this is like my favorite oregano that I grow. I add it to pizzas, add it to sauces, add it to everything. Add it to my soups.
Ooh.
That's like my favorite.
That's intense.
I like the intenseness, yeah. Hot and spicy oregano.
It's definitely different than the other one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's a cool thing. I mean, if you're growing, I mean, if you go to the store to buy oregano, they just sell oregano, but you have hot and spicy oregano. We have, you know, all different kinds of za'atar and all different kinds of stuff. Different kinds of lettuces. All right, and then over here, this will be a fun one. I won't tell you what it is. Try a leaf and tell me if you can figure it out. Here's just a little single leaf.
Okay.
You get enough flavor on that?
Mm-hmm. Is it rosemary?
Nope. I mean, it looks like rosemary.
It looks like rosemary. But it's got much more of a
smell. It's a smell that you might have smelled before in an essential oil or something like that. It's in Herbes de Provence.
Oh.
Lavender.
Lavender.
It's lavender leaf.
Lavender. Never would have got that one.
Yeah, and the flowers are edible too. They're purple.
Yeah, that's cool.
The bees love it too, yeah.
Tasty.
And I think we've got only two more things, actually. I wanted you to try this right here. So this is my more mature Lola Rosa. I planted this a bit too early, as I'm noticing now, because it's actually bolting. And but you can really see, like, the leaves are a lot more red than the other baby ones, because this is more mature, and I'll probably have to replace this with something else. But you also, now you can really taste the bitterness in these, because I was eating these the other day, and I'm like, well, those are actually kind of bitter, but I don't really care. But I'm like, right. Whoa, I wonder if other people are going to like these. But maybe they'll be sweeter for you. I don't know.
So far, pretty neutral.
Oh, neutral.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Now I can taste bitter.
More pronounced than the other ones, or about the same?
I would say that fire leaf was more bitter than this one.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. Maybe you have to try another one of these. Let's see. I had some the other day that was like pretty bitter, but maybe.
That one was decent. But I just ate a lavender, so.
Yeah, just ate lavender. Taste buds are messed up.
Right? Okay. It's really hydrating.
Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, it's all just really water-rich, man. I mean, these are more mature, and I encourage you guys to eat your lettuce stalks, too, you know? So these are stalking out and getting really tall. I'll just harvest and eat the stalks on these. They're nice and hydrating. If they're baby like this, they're still maybe not as bitter, but when they get more mature, they get a lot more bitter.
Not bad.
All right, maybe they're not quite as bitter as I thought. Or maybe I just got you lucky ones that aren't quite as bitter as the ones I picked.
So good.
Now I got a few things in the flood table that I want to share with you guys. I grow lots of different things. Some of the stuff in the flood table is like basil I never got to plant, but I got some cool stuff, including this guy right here. This is watercress.
Watercress.
So yeah, I grow watercress in the water of my flood table, and here's a nice fresh leaf. This is like literally planted like a month or two ago, and this is even in a pot. You can see, oh look, it's got a ton of worms in there too, man. That's so crazy.
Wow, they're loving it up.
It's alive. So yeah, how's that fresh watercress?
Oh, so good.
It's like so different.
I think I've only had it a couple times because it's really hard to find in certain areas.
Yeah.
Like you can't really normally get it. So I've only had it a couple times, but this is good. It's,
This might be peppercress, but it's one of those cresses, you know?
It's
hydroponically grown, and that you could get it at most stores, you know? And I literally just took it out of the package and just plopped it in there in the thing, and then it just grows. And then when I'm here working, I'll just, like, pick off leaves and just nibble on them.
It's very peppery.
Yeah.
I like it.
And then another one I'm growing in here, and it grows in the shade of my, in the back normally. It's this guy, and this is actually another, wow, yeah, peppery, I'm tasting it.
Yeah.
This is another genera. This is genera bicolor, also known as Okinawan spinach.
Oh.
So like maybe from Japan or something like that. So let's pluck you off a nice, more smaller leaf on here. This one doesn't like the full sun, doesn't like the heat.
So look at the color.
I grow in the shade.
Side.
Yeah, I really love the purple coloring.
And it's almost like iridescent.
Yeah.
Because it's not purple unless you look at it.
Yeah. I mean, I really love the coloring
on these
guys.
Because in the sun
you
can't see it purple, but in the shade you can.
Yeah.
That's cool.
And it likes growing in the shade.
Mmm. Yep, spinachy.
So compare that to the longevity spinach you had a little bit earlier, because it's kind of like the same kind of related family of plants.
Mmm. I do like this one better.
Yeah, this one's a lot harder to grow in this climate. The longevity spinach likes full sun, but this likes the shade, so you could kind of grow them accordingly for the best results. So another plant, which is one of my favorites, it does have a hard time here in Vegas, but I found the best location for it is in the corner of my house. It gets the least amount of sun in the summertime and also keep it wet and watered. You guys can see I got it to, you know, flower up really nice this season, and it's gonna be making the seed pods actually, which is cool because I've never really had that when I planted it in full sun. And this is known as Ashitaba. It's from Japan, like a Hoshijo Island, and there's a lot of medical benefit to this. And so right now it's actually in the flower stage, so the leaves will be stronger. In California, like the leaves are a lot more mellow, so this should probably taste a bit more, you know, strong, especially because it's in its flower stage and it's grown in Vegas.
It's instantly strong. Mm-hmm. Very fibrous, very minerally, not quite bitter, but that's good.
Yeah, so this is in the celery family of plants.
Celery, that's what it is.
Yeah, and
definitely.
Like normally what I do, I eat the leaves sometimes, but I normally just harvest the stalks and make a Ashitaba leaf or a stalk juice, kind of like people would make celery juice. Mm. And that's one of the ingredients in my green juice normally, which is most of the year when I have the stalks. Right now my plants are in flower, so I don't have a lot of stalks to eat. This is one of my favorite plants actually in the world, just because it just grows really nice, and it actually has these things called chalcones. So if you cut it open, it bleeds this like yellow sap. And these chalcones have been, you know, shown in scientific studies to be like anti-disease, like hardcore. So I've really been trying to grow a lot of, like, you know, super healthy vegetables that literally money can't buy, like the Ashitaba and like some of the other things you've seen in this video so far. So the last green, and I don't even know how many we've gotten so far, but I'll put, once again, all the names of the plants right down below, first comment. This is called Oha Santa, and this is one that you definitely don't want to eat a lot of, because it in high amounts can not be healthy, but small amounts it's fine, so we're just going to give Lissa like a nice little small baby new growth leaf.
New growth.
I think in other countries where it's from, like South America, Mexico, they basically use this to like wrap up foods and eat with and maybe cook it up. I just eat it raw.
Peppery.
Like in a salad, yeah.
Peppery.
And it also has
bitter.
Probably another... Bitter?
Ooh.
Has probably another flavor that's maybe coming out.
It tastes licorice-y.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's what I was looking for, licorice.
Yeah.
I'm going to try a leaf too.
Licorice-y. But that one was bitter towards the end. But yeah, licorice.
I don't get bitter myself. I get,
woo.
Maybe I'm used to it.
Yep,
I'm acclimated to all my bitter stuff because this is like what I eat every day. To me, it's not bitter, but I mean, I taste astringent, like, and I taste licorice.
Licorice. It's also a little numbing.
Yeah,
as well.
Yeah, I get that too. Little bit numbing, but you know, once again, this is one of those leaves. I'd pick like three leaves to put in a big salad. So I'm not eating tons of this, but I'm getting the benefits of the different nutrients in there.
That was good. I actually really like that.
Yeah, and this thing, this is a perennial, so it'll die back in the winter. Actually, this last winter wasn't too cold, so one stalk stayed alive. But it basically dies back in the winter, and then in the spring, this year's growth from the springtime.
Wow.
It just grew tall. I mean, this thing's like taking over this whole bed, basically. This is a spreader, guys. So if you live like in Florida or somewhere where it doesn't get cold, watch out, this is gonna take over your garden. But hey, if I had like 40 acres, I'd let this take over a whole area and just have a whole area of this so I could eat it anytime. So that's pretty much the end of the tour. I don't even know how many greens we tried, maybe like over 3-4 dozen. I don't know, links down below and with the plant names so you guys could know all of them if you guys want to buy any to grow yourself. But Lissa, what was your overall comments of trying all these leaves? Because you've never really had an experience like this in your life where you could literally go to some dude's backyard in the city, nonetheless, that you live, to like try so many different varieties of plants, like all fresh, that you just, you know, people never get to do. Because, I mean, you go to the grocery store and you buy food, which, as you learn, tastes nothing like my backyard grown stuff. What are your comments to everybody out there?
Yeah, definitely grow your own, even if it's in a pot somewhere, as long as you're able to, because the flavors are just so different and you don't realize how much variety there is out there until you do something like this, until you try different things, especially grown in, even just grown in different areas of the yard tasted different. So also mineral-rich soils grown at different times of the year, in-season stuff. Just incredible, the different flavors. Like, my mouth is just like a whole party full of flavors. I can't believe how many that I've tried just in this little space.
Yeah, and I do focus on trying to grow as many varieties as possible and finding ones that are easy to grow in my climate. And of course, if I lived in a different climate, I'd be growing different plants. But wherever you guys live, I mean, I live in one of the hottest climates in the United States, and yet I'm still able to grow all these amazing things. And there are even more that I'm not even growing. And I try to have videos on my channel all the time, share with you guys unique and different style plants that you're not going to hear on other common gardening channels that are just growing common things. I grow a lot of uncommon things because I really know about some of their health benefits. Oh, and there's one you didn't try. You didn't try my Ashitaba leaves, but maybe we'll save that for another video. There's only a few of them on there. But yeah, I just thought of that one. But anyways, I grow a lot of different weird things. I want to encourage you guys to grow your own food, seek out new and different life forms, I mean varieties, on different planets and or different countries, and grow them yourself. Yeah, live long and prosper too. You know, it's just so amazing. So listen, at the end of this episode, what were your favorite top five that you would recommend people out there grow, because it just tasted and blew you away? It tasted so good and blew you away.
Yeah, okay, so I would think that the number one, obviously I have my favorites flavor-wise, but the number one that blew me away was the spinach.
The spinach?
Yeah, that was the most surprising.
Yeah. Fresh spinach tastes nothing like the store guys. Like, incredible.
Yeah, just simply for the fact that I would not have guessed that was spinach, and it tastes totally different than spinach. Like, it was like a different plant.
Vegetable.
Really, different vegetable. The second, I would say, obviously my favorite would be the garlic.
The garlic leaf.
The garlic from the leaf.
Italian purple garlic.
That one, and then also the baby green onions.
The baby green onions, love your onions. Yeah, but they're so flavorful and they're so good, and people just get these stupid onions in like a six pack in the store, and they don't even taste like my green onions that are like more mild or those, and you don't get to choose when you harvest them when you buy them from the store. They just harvest them when they think it's ripe.
Yeah.
You could harvest them when you grow them at any stage, like all my baby leaves that I love so much.
Definitely. I would also say in the top five would be the lemon basil.
The lemon basil, that first thing you tried.
Yeah.
Wow, that's impressive. Yeah, that's kind of grown in the shade, and that plant did not perform well for me. Usually basils do well in my climate, and I had some actually in this bed here, but they just faded out pretty early. They didn't make a lot of leaves, but they taste good for sure.
Yeah, that was so cool. Like, the amount of lemon flavor was so awesome. And then I would, obviously, my favorite is the weed that grows the water pepper.
Water pepper, yeah. So that's that hot, spicy weed you tried at the beginning. It probably lit your mouth up so hardcore. That's a very easy one to grow. I mean, it literally will reseed itself, and it just grows like literally like a weed. You don't really even have to water. It'll come up where you don't want it. I end up cutting out a lot of them during the season because it's like I don't want them to grow like everywhere and then take over everything, although I do want to have some every year without me doing any work. And that's one of my favorite plants because I love those plants that you plant once, it goes to seed, drop seeds, and they just come up on their own. And you know, one of these days maybe I'll have a whole garden full of plants like that.
Volunteers.
Yeah, volunteers. Yep. But yeah, until then I'm planting a lot of plants.
Yeah, those would be my top five. But I loved everything too. I loved experiencing the texture of the mucilaginous ones.
Or the texture of like the fig leaf, you know, the cinnamon that's really thick and like fibrous.
Just being able to try different things, considering we just don't have the ability.
You can't do that at the grocery store. You get whatever the farmers grow and they're selling in trade that actually will last through their shipping process, which is cold storage. And a lot of the greens, especially some of the Asian greens that are summer greens, like, they don't like the cold. They will not handle the cold. They'll wilt very fast.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so thanks, John.
Oh, this has I'm glad you were able to enlighten you and hopefully spread some knowledge and inspire some people out there to start growing their own food, to have higher quality food. I mean, if you're a chef, it's a no-brainer that you guys should grow your own garden. Grow your own gardens for your restaurant. Hire a local farmer or contractor. Hire people to grow your food for your gardens. I mean, some of the top chefs in the country know this, and they grow a garden for that very reason, right?
Yep.
I mean, what is it? French Laundry, you know, comes to mind. I mean, that dude pioneered this stuff, growing your own food to have higher quality flavors. And if even if you just want better health, like I'm growing my garden for my health, you know, I have more nutrition, more flavor, more everything. It just makes my diet more sustainable. So I want to stick to eating lettuce and other greens. People, lettuce tastes so nasty. Well, dude, grow yourself, grow many varieties, find the one you like and eat that. Eat more plant foods. Plant foods are the best foods on the entire planet for planetary health and for your health. And if you grow them yourself, they taste better. You'll eat more, your kids will eat more, and especially if you got kids, grow a garden because they could get involved with the process and learn how real food should taste, where it comes from, and get them invested in it. They'll like to eat more vegetables, and you will do them a favor over their entire lives because now they're eating healthier because you simply took the time to grow a garden for you and your family.
Love it.
And that's why I really make my YouTube videos for you guys. I'm glad, Lissa, you are here to share your comments and inspire some people. So if somebody wants to learn more about you and your healthy recipes that you create in your books and your amazing photography, how can somebody pick up one of your ebooks so they could start eating healthier plant-based today, and maybe they even grow some of their vegetables and use the vegetables they grew in your recipes to even make your recipes taste better?
Oh yeah, I could only imagine how much more awesome my recipes would be, but my YouTube channel is Lissa's Raw Food Romance, and you can get any of the recipe ebooks that I have at payhip.com/rawfoodromance. And right now there is 40% off code. It's rawfood40. So if anyone was interested, the ebooks are 40% off. But you can also find me on Instagram at rawfoodromance and on Facebook, Lissa's Raw Food Romance too.
Wonderful, Lissa. Thank you so much. I will put links down below in the description so you can check out Lissa and all her amazing work as well. If you guys enjoy this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up, and please be sure to share this video with as many people as possible so that they can learn the power and the benefits and how good homegrown food can taste, as well as all the different varieties that literally money cannot buy in the grocery store. Even Donald Trump can't buy some of these things. Or whoever has a lot of money, because you literally got to grow them yourself to have them. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes that come in every 5 to 7 days. Even under wear a shirt, or you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure you click the little bell to get notified as and my new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,600 episodes at this time on this channel, to inspire you to grow your own food and how to grow your own food to empower you to be better stewards of yourselves and the planet. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.